Hello everyone, welcome back to HackConf 2021. This is our online edition and I'm your host Gennady. We're back with another talk. Our next lecture is about making sense of stream processing, and it's by Filareta Yordanova. She's a technical architect at Experian and she has a very diverse experience. She has did a research project, she did ML, signal processing and event-driven architecture. So please, thank you.
Thank you very much for the nice introduction. Hi, folks. Okay, what are we going to talk about during the next 40 to 50 minutes? As you can see, the topic of today's presentation is making sense of stream processing. What do we mean by stream processing, actually? Well, we will touch upon the idea of using event streams as a way of enhancing application architecture, or also as a way of enriching our systems with additional data. Those approaches could be often useful for making our systems more robust and help us in the face of increased scale. Well, they already introduced me, but I will say a few words about me. As you already know, my name is Filareta, and I've been working as a software engineer for almost eight years now. Part of my interests are data streaming. I'm also curious about event-driven and microservices architectural patterns, big data tools, and I like playing around with NoSQL storages. Without further introductions, let's go directly into our agenda for today. So, what will we be discussing? Let's first clarify the terminology in different fields of computing, because you will see that actually this could be a bit confusing from time to time. Then we will take two case studies. We will use them during the talk as examples so that we can represent better the idea of using event streams. And we will finish this this part of the talk with summarizing some advantages from the usage of communication with events. And the next section will be just a simple touch on several tools that could be useful in practice. I want to highlight here that the talk is mostly relying on clarifying some concepts. So this will not be a deep technical dive in any particular tool or a technology, but I will just highlight them so that we can make the talk a bit more practical. And at the end, we will finish with some curious, at least for me, examples of where in other fields in computing, structuring data as logs could be quite useful. And by logs here, we don't mean application logs, like log4j or something like this, but we actually mean structuring data like this. Great. Let's now proceed with this terminology clarification. Okay, so events is a really quite popular term, and I'm sure you've heard it a lot, but structuring data as a stream of events, it's actually not a new concept at all. Truth is that events have been in different fields, and they have been used in architectural approaches quite a lot. And as I mentioned in the beginning, some confusion may arise here because in different communities, underlying concepts and ideas are pretty similar actually, but the terminology could be different. Let's see here on the slide. I have marked a short list of different fields that make a good use of communication with events. Let's pick up stream processing first. What is actually stream processing all about? We can define it simply as taking action on a series of data. Stream processing is often associated with internet companies, like, for example, LinkedIn, And why is that? Because nowadays, a significant amount of the tools used in the stream processing field have actually started from such type of a company. For example, Apache Kafka have started as a project in LinkedIn, actually. We associate stream processing usually with processing large data sets that are used for analytical purposes. And yeah, data could sometimes data is not very well structured. If we moved to the next field, let's take the next abbreviation, which stands for complex event processing. In complex event processing, we usually process data on an event-by-event basis. The term originated in an event simulation research done in the early 90s. And here we have more complex transformations on the data usually. The next one is event sourcing. Event sourcing has its roots in the domain-driven design. Here we have more complex models compared to the ones used in the stream processing field. And also we have complex models, more complex transformations, and smaller data sets to work in with compared to the stream processing. And last but not least, let's quickly check what do we mean by reactive and how reactive actually makes use of events. The paradigm for reactive programming actually relies solely on the use of asynchronous programming model to automatically update content that's otherwise static. So it's mainly concerned with the use of data stream, structuring data again as a stream, and the automatic propagation of change. Okay, let's finish up with the theory and continue to the use cases that I've promised you earlier. Let's pick up the first case study. It's actually from the stream processing field. Let's imagine that we are talking about Google Analytics. What's Google Analytics? In a quick summary, we are collecting events that further on can be used to actually create statistics or see how our website is used. You can see here on the slide that I have prepared a simple example of an event. For example, we might have an event type, which in this case is page view event. We have a timestamp, of course, of the event, the IP address, session ID, and other useful details related with the client's browser, for example, and how we got to this page. It's very important to highlight here that each page view event is a simple immutable fact. It simply records that an action has been performed by the user. So the curious thing, and actually the more interesting part that we are going to discuss now, is how to basically create this nice graphical dashboard and the representation that's useful to the final users from this raw data. Broadly speaking, we have two options for this one. The first option is storing the raw data directly, for example, in something like a data warehouse or a Cassandra cluster, if you would like. And second option is, of course, directly doing aggregation on the streams of events and take only the data that we care about. Calculate these page views and all of the rest will be discarded. Well, if we continue to discuss a bit more the two different options, you might think that the first option sounds a bit crazy even, but it's a fact actually that nowadays modern analytical databases have become really good at scanning quickly over large data sets. So we usually perform simpler queries here and do some aggregation on the fly on the data that we would like to use. This storage of raw events actually gives us really, really good flexibility for further analysis. We can use this data for offline processing, like training machine learning models, for example, recommender systems, and stuff like this. For option B, this is the immediate aggregation of the data. This one can be quite useful when scanning the raw data is too slow. For example, if you would like to implement something like a rate limiter on your website so that you need to prevent basically users from scraping your content from your website. If you imagine that you would be rescanning the historical data, that will be ridiculously slow even. So in this case, it's useful to directly do aggregations while consuming this event stream. Another example could be monitoring a person's heart rate. Actually, you would like to be responding fast here. And for example, if you are monitoring a window of the data, then for sure it's better to aggregate immediately on this stream. But you also might want to keep this raw information, because if you are using some more sophisticated algorithm, for example, for detecting anomaly on the person's heart rate, then you most possibly need this raw data to tune up your thresholds or train any particular algorithm for that purpose. So as a conclusion, we might say that both representations and both approaches are very useful. They just have different usages. Let's be a bit more visual and see how we can actually implement this streaming aggregation. All right, we can simply increment a counter and then store it in some type of distributed cache. But now let's imagine that you have implemented your rate limiter using that approach, and then another requirement comes to you with the ask that you now need to also keep the raw data, because the data analysts would like to trace the user sessions and do some more analysis on the additional data. Then how would you approach that? Let's see the next example. What I could propose you actually is to introduce the so-called event stream, or event log is also a suitable abbreviation. I hope we will see later on in the presentation why calling it a log is also an appropriate label. So this way we can keep both functionalities, and even now we have the freedom to attach another consumer of the data, for example, for monitoring purposes or drawing some additional charts as a dashboard to represent to the final user. Great. As promised in the beginning, we will be reviewing two case studies. So the next case study is from a different field. The idea here is to basically view the parallel between the fields and how the idea is quite similar, but it's just a different case study. Well, let's say a few words about event sourcing. We will put it simply now, and we will extend the definition with the continuation of our explanation about the example. Putting it simply, event sourcing is mainly concerned with how do we structure basically the data in our database. If we take this example, this table is representing a shopping cart from an e-commerce website, let's say. And now imagine that we are a customer that would like to order from product 123. No, we are customer 123, and we want to order product 888. Let's say those are bananas, to be easier. So now we cannot decide on the quantity that we would like to order, and we change our opinion on a couple of times. Well, probably you don't see any issue with this approach, since all of the user actions are easily transformed to a very classical approach with performing update statements on your database. What's the problem with this one? Well, the problem could be that finally you have only the last state, and you have actually no clue of what has changed during making this order. When this could be a minus, let's say that you're making great discounts on your website for holidays like Christmas or Thanksgiving, and you want to further analyze how good your discounts actually are. You might want to view the time taken to make the order, if the customer has changed his opinion, or at the end decided not to order at all. How to approach this problem in a different way? Well, I'm probably a bit annoying, but again, we can represent each user action with a separate event. So events, again, have a timestamp. And now every change to this shopping cart is a simple immutable event, so it stands as a fact, because it's true that at some point of time I have made the decision to order two bananas. It doesn't matter that at the end I have decided for them to be three. So this prevents overriding data in the database. And just a simple example here, you might use different types of events, for example, for adding a product or for placing the order at the end. And finally, with this example, we basically reach to the essence of event sourcing. And it's always prefer immutable events and avoid state mutation. So the foundational idea of event sourcing is really to be able to capture the application state as a sequence of events. Now you are probably thinking, okay, great, I got all of these details, I now got all of these events stored, so how I'm going to query the state or something like this. Okay, let's continue with the talk, and I hope you will find an answer to this question of yours. If we now think for both the cases that I gave you as an examples, both the event-sourced database and also the sequence of these page view events, they are becoming to look quite similar to one another, actually. So both the sequence of events and the event-sourced database are comprising the history of what happened over time. This representation of the data is well optimized for writes. In order to be quick on the reading side, we need to actually replay those events in order to get the current state on our system. So replaying all of the events, integrating them, will give us the end result. And this is the form that's well optimized for read queries. So storing aggregated data is well optimized for reading. You might heard the term materialized view, actually, in a combination with event sourcing. You could be keeping checkpoints of your event store so that you do not need to replay the whole history every time. And in a lot of situations, what I'm trying to say is that it makes sense to separate the way you write to your system from the way you read from it. And this pattern is known as common query responsibility segregation. If we continue to think even further about the user interfaces, because at the end of the day, the user interfaces are actually the way people interact with the systems that we are building. Each raw event is actually triggering a database write. So these raw events are very simple, and they can, for example, be generated from the user by clicking a button or writing a comment and then submitting it. Aggregated data, on the other side, are produced by database reads, and they are usually associated with the final screens that the users see. You can see here that I've put Facebook as an example. So imagine that you're clicking a like button. What could happen at the backend side? For example, we might generate a very simple event, which has your user ID, also the action that you've performed, and the ID of the item that you liked. But here, look at the post. The post is actually more complex. It contains a lot of data. We need to aggregate data from different sources. We need to perform complex query. And in order to speed up this process, we might have the so-called translation process, which can actually take the very simple raw events as input and then produce this massively complex and personalized output structure in the form of a post in your user newsfeed, let's say. So the example that we viewed, actually, these raw events generated by the buttons in Facebook, those raw events can be viewed as the source of truth for our system. Why? Because they can be used to derive all of the views and the different states that you need to use to display valuable data to your user. And the nice thing here is that this process is entirely deterministic. This separation between source of truth and aggregated data, which is derived from them, is actually very nice for optimizing your read views. Now you can denormalize data and produce different data views or copies of your data. Well, this is usually stated as a very bad practice, but if we talk about standard relational databases, the traditional approach, and why so? Because if you actually copy your data a couple of times, it's very different to keep the data in sync when the original data changes. But why is the case here different? Because we actually know what are the data flows in our overall system. Why we know this? Because we have introduced this abstraction called an event stream, and the property of this stream is that it's an append-only sequence, it's an append-only stream of immutable-only data, immutable events. Now we have the freedom to have different consumers subscribe to this event stream. We can transform the data a bit and load it into some cold storage, we can build search indexes, useful caches, and we can even build another representation of diff events of this input event stream. We can join with another sources of data, enrich the stream, and produce another output stream again, which could be used as the input for another application. This is actually a very powerful way of building more complex systems in a cleaner way. So to finish up with this section, let's quickly summarize the advantages of the introduction of these event streams. First one is loose coupling. Why loose coupling? Because as we already saw, we now have the freedom to separate the model that we use for reading from the model that we use for writing our data. And we naturally move to the next advantage, which is read and write performance together. Because now we can use different schemas for reading and writing. Also, scalability. Event streams are a very simple abstraction, and they are great for scalability. They can help you to decompose your system into independent producers and consumers so that you can scale those pieces independent from one another. And you can also benefit from better model for parallel execution. Flexibility and agility. When we speak about this simple raw event data, we usually don't talk too much about schema migration because you might add a new field to your events from time to time. You can keep versions of your message payload, and that's okay. But what you usually don't need to do is to rewrite all of the historical data that you have. You can easily build a different representation of the data, and you can even experiment with new version of your system and run it in parallel with the old one. And last but not least is auditability and error recovery. Actually, it's quite natural since we talk about immutable data, and we can also replay events because events are persisted for a configurable amount of time. This probably depends on the implementation of the event stream that you are using, but it's important to have the ability to replay these events because you can, for example, repair data in case of a failure. Okay, now let's move to the second section of the talk. As I've promised in the beginning, in order to make the session a bit more practical, we will quickly discuss some tools that could be handy in practice. As a first one, I've marked Apache Kafka here. And the reason for this one is that I've been talking so much for event streams, and it would be a shame if I'm not putting just a note here which tool implements exactly this paradigm behind. So this is what exactly Apache Kafka is doing. The event streams in Apache Kafka are implemented as an append-only transaction logs, or you might see it as a distributed commit log. The abstraction that they use in Apache Kafka is called topic, so data is durably stored on disk, it's replicated, it's also partitioned, and etc. But this is not a deep technical dive in Apache Kafka. So I will move to the next bullets. The next two of the tools that I've listed here for you are actually how we can consume this event stream after we've produced it. And the first one is called Kafka Streams. It's very tightly integrated with the Kafka ecosystem because it integrates with Apache Kafka, actually, as for the input and also for the output side. It's building on top of the producer and consumer libraries. It gives you some additional guarantees like fault tolerance, distributed coordination. It supports joining streams of data or joining streams with static content, windowing operations. If you remember the example that we gave with the orange box here, this process that could transform input event stream to an output event stream, we can say that Kafka Streams is a very suitable tool for this part. And the last one is Spark Structured Streaming. I've put here Structured Streaming because this is the improved version of the way we can do streaming in Spark. The first version in the first major release was called only Spark Streaming. And Structured Streaming does some improvements, and I think it's available from the second major release, but since now we've reached 3 point something, probably it's a good idea to discuss Structured Streaming instead. So it also supports some stateful streaming operations, aggregations, event time-based windowing. I think that this actually, the notion of event time is new in structured streaming. We can handle late events data. So it's built on top of the Spark SQL engine. And actually, Spark is very popular in the analytics field. And if you already use it, for example, for batch processing job, structured streaming could be quite natural for you to use for the streaming part. Okay, a few more words for Kafka Streams. You can see here, actually, on the diagram, it's represented what I've just said. Kafka Streams is useful for building complex topologies, but it's inside Kafka, actually. We can have in the input topic some raw events data that we want to clean up, filter in some form, produce different formats, and then publish it to an output topic, for example, if we have a lot of other parties interested in this information. From time to time, you might like to, for example, load data into your Kafka cluster from an external source or write to an external sink. For this one, it's recommended to check on the Kafka Connect API. Actually, the Kafka Connect API gives you the ability to standardize a bit the interface that you use for building these capabilities for loading and storing data. And those ones are called connectors. There is a variety of open source or ready to use for you connectors, for example, JDBC for the source side, loading from different types of databases. Or storing your data to different type of object storages, Cassandra, MongoDB, and various databases. The recommended way to run these connectors is, of course, in a distributed mode. For this part, well, you will need a bit of additional infrastructure, and it's the Kafka Connect cluster. You connect it to the original Kafka one, and the Connect cluster contains of a couple of workers in order to ensure fault tolerance of the work that you submit to it. How we achieve it, the work in each in each connector is split further into tasks. So if some of the workers in the Kafka Connect cluster goes down, this task could be rescheduled on another healthy one. And a few additional words for Spark streaming. We talk about structured streaming. Spark has very nice integrations with a couple of other tools in the Hadoop ecosystem. If we particularly speak about structured streaming, it also has a nice integration with Kafka as a source. It has really nice to use integration for different data formats, like, for example, you can easily produce and store JSON, CSV, or Parquet files. You can store into Google Cloud Buckets or S3 quite easily. And here on the diagram in the right corner, below you actually see the main concept of Spark streaming. So this is the initial way of doing streaming in Spark. The input stream is divided into small chunks, which are called micro batches. And then those batches are taken and transformed from the Spark engine. Part of this concept is also kept in structured streaming. Now in structured streaming, we have two different processing engines. The default one is again microbatch, and from 2.3, I think it was, they've introduced a processing engine called continuous processing, which can improve the latencies even further. So the main concept in structured streaming is to look at your data as a continuous input table, which is constantly appended on each trigger. We basically take new data and process it and append it to the result. Here on the table, you can see basically a quick summary of the two tools that we discussed. I've already explained a bit about the processing model in structured streaming. And for Kafka streams, we actually don't have microbatches. We rely on event at a time processing. So you can have really low latency here. It's real time, whether the microbatch approach is more like near real time. And as you probably already noticed from what we talk about for Spark structured streaming, well, you will need a separate processing cluster. For Kafka streams, that's not the case. So it's just a library, and it's really more suitable for integrating it into your microservice, for example. It scales easily by just adding Java processes. It doesn't need reconfiguration. Well, for structured streaming, depending on the cluster manager that you use, you might need some reconfiguration from time to time. It's a standalone framework. And if we talk about processing guarantees, Kafka Streams is said to give you exactly one processing guarantees, but that's true when the input system and also the output system is again Kafka. And that is because it integrates tightly with some lower level transactional APIs in Kafka and treats Kafka as an internal system opposed to other tools that can be used for processing the stream. Okay, for structured streaming, we have exactly one semantics for the batch processing mode. Actually, that's one of the things that structured streaming improves over Spark streaming. And with some restrictions, maybe. This could be achieved using checkpointing, and it also uses write-ahead logs while processing your data. So the syncs that we use to read data from should support should support replaying the events, and the syncs should support idempotent operations, which means that if you execute the same operation a couple of times, the result will not change. It should be like exactly you've executed this operation once. And both of the tools are actually fault tolerant. They just achieve it in a different way. Kafka Streams, for example, relies really on Kafka, and it uses internal topics to manage this. Okay, to summarize this section, I propose to quickly review a simple example related with some integration issues. Let's imagine that we want to support writing to different data storages. For example, we want from our web application to write data as usual in some database, then we want to support some data representation in a cache so that we can speed up some operations, and we want to also maintain a search index. Well, you probably already got this, but the order in which we write the data, the order in which we transform the data is really very important. Why it's important? Because we want to avoid data inconsistencies. Eventual consistencies here are, let's say, fine, but we don't want to be in a place where we need to repair our data or sync the storages manual somehow. So this could be easily occur in partial failures or race conditions during writing the data to the storages. Can we approach this in a different way? Well, yes. Of course, we are talking about this approach now for a half an hour. Why don't applying it here as well? How we can apply it? We can have our web application, instead of directly writing to these storages, appending the data to such type of event log. And I've put here on the diagram that it's recommended to be Kafka. Why? We already discussed why. Because that's the way Kafka actually implements topics on its side. So logs are append-only event sequences. And now you have here the nice thing that all of the consumers are now processing the data sequentially. Data is processed in sequential order. And also they are independent from each other, which means that if some of them fails, this failure will not be cascaded to the rest of the consumers. And of course, since you can replay those events, you can, for example, fix the bug and not lose the data later on. And the last part of the presentation, as I promised, will be just highlighting several curious examples of how structuring data in logs could be useful and where it is actually used in different areas of computing. The first example that you see here is database replication. Database replication can be achieved with different approaches. The one I've picked here is something like a traditional way of doing it. We can have a database which is deployed as a highly available system, and it's usually the case that we designate one of the nodes to be the leader, and the rest of the nodes are called followers. So only the leader in green accept write requests, all of the others accept read requests. Now, the question is how to propagate the new data to the follower nodes, and you can see here that this is achieved with something called replication lock. The replication lock is also append-only sequence with data. The last bullets says Kafka, but we already discussed it a couple of times. Let's move to the next example. The next example is actually from database engines. It's true that a significant part of the database engines are implemented using some type of tree structure, but database engines do not end up with this approach. So there is something like a class called log structure storages. And I gave here as an example Cassandra or HBase. You can see on the picture that the log could be broken into segments. And from time to time, those segments are merged with each other, and duplicate data is discarded so that we can facilitate searching in the data to make searches, for example, easier. But the main point here is that still those segments are logs, and they are only written sequentially, and data in the logs in those segments is again immutable. We are reaching towards to the last example that I've picked up, and it's from distributed consensus algorithms. What do we mean by distributed consensus? Let's pick up an example from real life. Let's say that you want to negotiate with your colleagues which restaurant are you going to pick up for lunch today. Well, in order to agree on something, you need at least the majority of your colleagues to agree on which restaurant you're going to pick. If we move to more technical side of the things, this similar problem stays when, for example, we want to decide who the leader of a partition in a Kafka topic is. Also, with the database deployment that we saw several slides ago, it's really very important for the nodes to agree which the leader of the cluster is, because otherwise we might reach to a state where we have significant data losses. And I gave you several examples of such algorithms, but the curious thing here, at least for me, is that Raft, for example, is one of the algorithms that is not only responsible for taking care of this part of the agreeing between the nodes of the system, which the next value would be, but also it keeps a log of values of all the values that have been agreed over time. To finish up today's session, I've prepared a small slide with several resources that might be useful for you. Here on the bullets, you can see basically links to documentation of the different tools that we discussed, and two books that I find really useful. The first one is actually the inspiration for my talk today. And as for designing data intensive applications, it's actually a bigger one, and it goes over beyond the idea of stream processing. It touches upon things like scalability, fault tolerance, storage types, different data formats, but I really think it's worth checking a section at least in which you are currently interested in. And that's all from my side. Thank you for the attention. I hope you enjoyed the talk, and stay curious and continue learning.
Thank you. Thank you, Filareta. Thank you a lot. We already have a few questions in Discord. Now it's a good time to ask them if you have more. Okay. So we have one question from Pam and Nikolaev, and it's what's your opinion on using event streams for processing and storing incoming metrics?
For processing and storing?
Incoming metrics.
Incoming metrics.
Yeah.
What do we mean by incoming metrics?
Like metric storage. Is event streaming suitable for this problem, or?
Okay. I believe it's suitable, yes, because when we talk about event streaming, for example, metrics are probably high-load data, and you are emitting updates very frequently. So I believe you can make use of it. For example, if you talk about sensor data or clickstream data produced by the users, to basically calculate some statistic on this click streams or sensor data, using such type of an event stream could be very useful. So I believe it can suit you well for metrics data in some sense.
Cool. Thank you. We have another one, and it's what's the main advantage of stream processing as compared to batch processing?
I believe they have different purposes, actually. So it depends on when you want to, how fresh you need your data to be. And batch processing and stream processing can be well combined in the same architecture, actually, if you need to process data fast and to react to some events, stream processing is better. If you need to just, for example, apply some transformation and it could be an offline process for a significant amount of data, then batch processing is good. But if you need more frequent updates that you need to show to your user and you need to be like an online transformation, then stream processing is better.
Okay, and our last question is, are Kafka topics like suitable for inputs to ML models, or like are they good for this kind of tasks?
Yeah, I think so. I think I can give you a more practical example. For in one of the projects that I've worked in, we actually used Kafka topics to collect events from different sensors. So basically, we had one consumer which was actually a Spark structured streaming job. So it listened to those events in real time, and we had a machine learning model integrated into this consumer. So in some window of time, we were just executing the model on the data. Yeah, that's very suitable, I think.
Cool. Thank you. Thank you again, Filareta.
Thank you.
That's all for us for this lecture, and we'll be back in 5 p.m. Sofia
time.